Dear friends, welcome to this edition of video lectures in Gross Anatomy on YouTube, a series under the title VBS Anatoma. Today we take up the first session on the gross anatomy of the lung. Earlier, if you recall, we had covered the detailed histology of the lung in a four-part series. Now we proceed to the next major area of coverage, namely the gross anatomy. In this part one of the video series, I will give you a general overview of the location and orientation of the lungs. I am Dr. Balasubramaniam. I work here as a professor in the Department of Anatomy, St. John's Medical College, Bangalore, India. Let's have a look at this photograph. This is from the cadaver. We have shown the interior of the thoracic cage. The anterior thoracic wall has been removed to show the three important structures in this cavity: the right lung, the left lung, and in between the two is the heart. You can see these three structures, three viscera, very beautifully shown. Next, that's the cut end of the chest wall. The upper cut has been shown. Roughly, there's a region where the manubrium and the upper ribs are located. Lower down, forming the boundary, is the diaphragm. The right and the left domes of the diaphragm are partly seen in this photograph. Now, this is same as the previous photograph, except that the heart has been removed to show some details and the immediate surrounding of the lung in a little more detail. You can see the right lung and the left lung. Since the heart has been removed, the structure behind the heart, that's the right and the left domes of the diaphragm that we covered in the last one. And now, immediately behind the heart, the trachea and the left bronchus. A small bit of the right bronchus is also visible, but that area is dark, so I have not labeled it. And going down the posterior mediastinum, you can see the esophagus. So these are the important structures that are identifiable in this particular photograph. Next, let's examine a cross section. As I told you, in all my lectures, I try my best to give you as much coverage as possible in cross-sectional anatomy domain also, because that adds to your understanding and interpretation of the relations of the structures. Now you see, here is a cross section, roughly mid-thorax. You can see the cross section of the right lung and the left lung. That's the parenchyma of the lung. The thoracic cage, namely the ribs and the intercostal spaces and its contents. Next, posteriorly, the thoracic vertebrae, heart in front, and in the small region between the thoracic vertebrae and the heart, that's the posterior mediastinum, containing, among other things, important big structure, the esophagus and the aorta. I repeat, esophagus and the aorta. Therefore, this is a beautiful cross section, roughly mid-thorax. You can see the heart, the lungs on either sides, the thoracic cage at the perimeter, the thoracic vertebra posteriorly, and in the posterior mediastinum, you can see the esophagus and the aorta. Next, surfaces of the lung. Now we know where the lung is placed inside the thoracic cavity, and we know how it's related to, of all things, the heart. Now you see, this is the costal surface of the right lung and the left lung, placed it together and photographed it together. Here you can see the lung is roughly like a pyramid with a base and two surfaces, an outer costal surface and an inner surface, or the medial surface, and an apex. It's obvious from this photograph that in anatomical position, the base is closely related to the respective domes of the diaphragm. The apex is the upper pointed area of the lung. This area roughly projects a little beyond the first rib, and here it is covered by a membrane. Now that's an important structure in the root of the neck, apex of the lung. So just remember this in that context. So I have shown the apex, I have shown the base. The apex is above and in the immediate vicinity and above the border of the inner border of the first rib. Lower part is the base, that entire area related to the respective dome of the diaphragm. Next, on the costal surface, you can see an oblique fissure in both the lungs. I repeat, an oblique fissure running downwards and forwards in both the lungs. However, in the right lung, there is an additional fissure that cuts across, it's more or less transverse, cuts across and moves towards the anterior border. Now that's the horizontal fissure. Generally speaking, the right lung is 3-lobed and the left lung is 2-lobed. This is because while both the lungs have an oblique fissure to demarcate the lobe, upper and lower, only the right lung has an horizontal fissure, which further demarcates a third lobe or the middle lobe. Next, same lung medial surface. I told you the lung has a costal surface or an outer surface, which roughly corresponds to the thoracic cage, inner aspect of the thoracic cage. A base or the diaphragmatic surface. I have shown the diaphragmatic surface in full view in this photograph. And the rest of the lung is the medial surface. I repeat, is the medial surface. Next. Here also you can see the oblique fissure in both the cases, the right lung as well as the left lung, on the medial side. However, in addition, on the right side, you can also see the other part of the horizontal fissure, which goes into the medial surface. So that's also shown. Therefore, on the right side, there are three lobes, a superior, middle and inferior, whereas on the left, it is a superior lobe and an inferior lobe. Next, the medial surface, quite extensive, is further divided into two areas. A larger anterior mediastinal surface and a posterior vertebral surface. The vertebral surface is a little in front of the posterior border. The point you need to understand is that is a surface which is closely applied to the on either sides of the vertebral column. In later videos, you will see that's the area related to the sympathetic trunk, the posterior intercostal vessels and nerves, things like that. So that's an important surface. The other surface is the mediastinal surface, where it's principally related to the middle mediastinum, heart and pericardium, and also structures coming in and going out. However, please remember, the most important signature feature of medial surface is this, the hilum of the lung. I repeat, hilum of the lung. The hilum is the point where structures enter or exit from the lung. I repeat, structures either enter the lung or exit from the lung. That's the place, therefore, where we expect to see the principal bronchus entering the lung, the pulmonary artery entering the lung, a pair of pulmonary veins exiting out of the lung. Of course, smaller details like bronchial artery, arteries, lymphatics can be added on. Now, this is the most important identifiable feature of the medial surface that makes it distinct from the other surface, namely the costal surface. Next, stretching below or pulling the hilum down is a fold of membrane, that is the pleura, which we call it as the pulmonary ligament. I repeat, it is called the pulmonary ligament. It is nothing but a flap of pleura. Next, borders. Some of the borders we have already noticed. Like for example, I mentioned the posterior border a little while back. But now let's examine the borders in detail. Now you see, again the same photograph. In the front view, where the anterior thoracic wall has been removed, you can identify, well, it's easy to identify the lung and the heart, lungs and the heart. The inferior border is very clear because it forms the perimeter or the edge of the base of the lungs. The anterior border, once again, very, very clear and visible, more or less straight in the right side, but a notched in the left side. That notch is the cardiac notch. I repeat, that is the cardiac notch of the anterior border. Now that projection, where the amount of there is no lung there, gives you an advantage because you can actually clinically, using a needle, you can actually reach the pericardial cavity because the heart, the little more of the heart and the pericardium is exposed in this view. This is a very important clinical point for tapping the pericardial fluid. This gives you an easy access where without touching the lung, you can actually reach the pericardial cavity. Now you see, back to the same photograph. Only thing is, we are going to identify the borders in exclusion. Because we know the borders in this surface, costal surface, the anterior border is well seen. Inferior border, again, I have shown, as shown in the previous photograph. Next, the posterior border. See, the basic difference between anterior and the posterior border is, comparatively, the anterior border is sharper. Goes without saying that the posterior border is a little rounded. That's how it fits into the contour of the paravertebral gutter. I repeat, that's how it fits into the contour of the paravertebral gutter in the thoracic cavity. Next, once again, even in the medial surface, you can still identify the anterior border. You can see it's quite sharp compared to the posterior border. Now, that in brief is an orientation of the lung in terms of its location, its orientation, and maybe a few important neighbors relations. There's much more to cover. I'm just giving you the preview of what's all coming in the future videos. Here is a lung where the hilum has been dissected. You can see the branching pattern of the tracheobronchial tree. The tracheobronchial tree divides into multiple branches. The branching from the tertiary bronchus onwards and the tissue of the lung it is supplied is called the bronchopulmonary segment. It is a surgically identifiable segment of the lung, which we will call it as the bronchopulmonary segment. So we will have a separate video on this with all the clinical details. You can also see blood vessels, namely the pulmonary artery and its branches, virtually accompanying the tracheobronchial tree. Similarly, the returning vein, pulmonary veins in one pair from each hilum will come through. So this is a demo of the tracheobronchial tree, the bronchovascular tree. Details I will cover in another video. You see, I have dissected the bronchovascular tree on the left side in fine detail. Again, we will go through this in detail separately. Now you see, if you make a silicone injection cast, the tracheobronchial, you inject that silicon into this silicon gel into this area, and this is how the tracheobronchial tree will appear. This is actually a specimen we made in the department, and you can see how beautifully the branching pattern is visible. Once again, I repeat, no discussion is complete without reference to corresponding image anatomy. Here is a plain X-ray chest PA view. The dark region on either sides of the heart is the lung because it contains air. So generally speaking, air containing structures will appear more darkish in X-rays. You can note that. You can see in white there are straps running across. Those are the ribs. That's a big area in the middle, heart. The thoracic cage, the edges are outlined. The diaphragm, the right diaphragm and the left diaphragm, the domes of the diaphragm are visible. Now see, a little more whitish patch in the center, inside the cardiac shadow, a little more whiter area right in the midline reflects the location of the thoracic vertebrae. And higher up, you can see in black there is a strip of a darkish area. That's the tracheal shadow. I repeat, that's the tracheal shadow. Don't confuse it with the white area around it. That's the white area is the thoracic vertebrae, whereas the one I'm showing now in black is the trachea, because trachea contains air, it casts a black shadow. Now you see, that's the aortic knuckle, also seen, although it's a cardiac related structure, it's prominently seen along the medial border of the lung. More importantly, you must have a look at these areas, slightly whitish branching pattern. That's the hilar shadow, mostly cast by the local blood vessels entering or exiting the lung. Generally, the tracheobronchial tree will not cast a white shadow because it contains air. That's why this whole region is slightly darkish in appearance. Now you see, a CT scan, roughly the mid-thorax. Please be informed that there is some pathology in this, but for the current discussion, we will ignore the pathology. Concentrate on the thoracic wall. The grayish area, grayish black area, is the lung parenchyma, and seen beautifully of course, the thoracic vertebra is there at the back, and the bronchovascular tree is, and the branching pattern is beautifully shown in this CT scan. Next, again another CT scan, coronal view, coronal projection. You can see the same bronchovascular tree in a beautiful contrast against the grayish black background. Now, the purpose of any anatomical study, human anatomy, is to give you a few glimpses of clinical pathology that you will encounter on the clinical practice. Here is a photograph where I told you in the previous one also there was a problem, but I didn't discuss it. But here, the photograph itself is being shown to focus on a pathology rather than the normal. You have seen a normal plain X-ray in the previous photograph. The point is, what I have put in that orange colored arrow, it is the left side, a part in the lower half of the lung region, looks like somewhere above the left diaphragm. See, that area is whitish. You see, it casts a white shadow. Compare it with the right side. On the right, it is dark and clear. That means the right lung is normal. Obviously, just common sense tells you to consider, well, an unusual white shadow on the left side may be some kind of a pathology. Given to understand that any fluid can produce a white shadow, it is possible that this is a case of a pleural effusion. It could be pus, or it could be a local secretion, or it could even be blood. All these are possible, and these will create a white shadow. Therefore, we have seen just one example of how in contrast, certain pathologies can be identified, a case of pleural effusion. Now, that was an overview of the introductory concepts relating to the gross anatomy of the lung. I hope you have enjoyed it. If there are any points for you, you need some more detailed thing, watch the future videos which I will be adding on. So you can also send me a feedback on this email ID of mine. Thank you, and wishing you all the best.